know how much you appreciate him today. What a beautiful Sunday school lesson this morning. Amen. Let's give her and the Lord a good hand clap today. What a great message, Sister Christian. Thank you. Let's sing and worship the Lord and let the Lord know we appreciate him. Let's just sing a chorus right now together. Would you do that?
Praise him, the one that we adore. Hosanna to the Lord of Lords. He's the great I am. Yes, he's the great.
He's the great I am. Thank you, Jesus. Thank God for the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Why am I telling you that the Lord is so good to us? God is so good to us. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to bless this service this morning. Bless the message and the messenger in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray that you would bless today. Bless our worship, Lord. God, touch those that have come in today and bless them. We pray, God, that you would touch souls and touch the bodies and spirits today. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Lift your hands and just thank the Lord today. Sister Creasy is going to lead our singing. You worship the Lord today.
Hallelujah. We talked about the victorious church, so let's sing There's Victory in Jesus today.
I heard an old, old story. How a Savior came. God opened. And how he gave his life. Atonement, oh, that I repented of my sin.
Hallelujah. Ain't you glad he went away to prepare a place for us? He said, where I am, there ye may be also. One day, it's going to all be over. The politicians has not got this in control. They don't even have Washington under control. They don't even have Crosstown under control. I'm going to tell you, but God's got everything under control. God is still on the throne. The revelator saw him when he went up. He said, I saw a throne and him that sat on that throne. And then he began to describe what Christ looked like. I'm going to tell you, there's still power in the name of Jesus Christ. Clap your hands and you may be seated. God bless you. We're going to receive our tithes and offering for our ushers come and help us out this morning. Sherry's going to bless us with a special number. God just going to just have his way here today. Good to have everyone. Christy's husband. God bless you, brother. Forgive me for forgetting your name. Okay? But I'm glad you're here today. Appreciate you being here. Sister Duke, glad you're feeling better. My old buddy sitting just to your right. Brother Cates, man. Thought he died, Brother Duke. Nobody called. I'm glad you're here, partner. Glad you're here. God's good to us, ain't he? Amen. Brother Michael, would you pray, please, sir? Thank you, Jesus.
Many times I question certain circumstances, things that I could not understand. Many times in trials, weakness blurred my vision. Oh, and my frustrations would get so out of hand. Oh, but it's been, I am reminded that I've never been forsaken. You know, I've never had to stand one test alone. Oh, then I look back on all my victories, and the spirit rises in me. Oh, and it's through the fire, my weakness is made strong.
so good to us. He is so good to us. I appreciate the Lord. Appreciate this church, the way you respond to worship to the word of the Lord. Amen. There's something about the word of the Lord that just gets you excited. You know, it's not like ball game. After that last pitch is thrown, that umpire says, you're out, and that's it. Everybody goes home, and that's it. But serving God, not that way. We go home, and we still have God with us. We still feel the effects of the Lord. And it's just great to know the Lord. If you have a Bible and want to stand with me to 1 Timothy 3:16, Greasy again, thank you for the word of the Lord this morning. I'm going to just try to take my, I'm going to take a lot of time. Maybe, you know, just, usually when a preacher says that, you can look out and you can preach all that. And I know, I'm going to try not to. That's like somebody says, oh, well, I'm not hungry. You better look out, he's sitting each other's house somewhere. Because he's not hungry. And, but God is so good. And I just appreciate it so much. 1 Timothy 3:16. And without controversy. No argument. Don't even want to talk about it. Without controversy. Great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. Justified in the spirit. Seen of angels. Preached unto the Gentiles. Believed on in the world. And received up into glory. I'm going to preach today. This is going to be a little different than the text for a little while. Then you'll, after I get on down a few minutes, a little while, then you're going to see where the text fits in. I'm going to preach today on heaven's best. Heaven's best. Play me a chord if you would. You can lay your Bible down if you could, or whatever you got in your hands, and lift your hands up to Jesus right now. And ask his anointing upon this. Service today. Pray, God, you anoint me. Lord, you minister to your precious people in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. We thank you for it, God. And everybody say amen. You may be seated. God bless you. Well, this is celebrating Memorial Day. And we certainly want to honor all of our troops that gave their life for this country. All our men and women that fought in wars in the past that have that sacrificed everything they had. As a little saying goes around, that many times we put it on our church signs, and we see it in other areas, that some gave, but some gave all. And that's a true story. It was in April of 1863 in Columbus, Mississippi, after decorating the graves of her two sons, who died representing their Southland, an elderly lady walked to two mounds of dirt at the corner of the cemetery to place memorial flowers there also, the story said. A friend asked her, what are you doing? These are the graves of two Union soldiers. Softly, that compassionate mother said, I know. I also know that somewhere in the North, a mother or a young wife mourns for them as we do for ours. That put in motion, according to the way I read it, our celebration of, and it has become known as Memorial Day, where we honor the war dead once a year. Their sacrifices is evident every day of the year. When you come to church, when you make your way to the house of God, when you go to that poll and push the candidate of your choice and able to cast your vote for whoever you vote for, and for whatever you're voting for that person for. When you do that, it's because of the sacrifice that our service people gave. Amen. We have veterans in this building today that gave a lot of sacrifice to the military, to their country. We have men and women that sacrifice. Brother Norton and I were talking before the service, or right after the service began, maybe in the office there as we was taking care of the Sunday school situation. And he said he remembered a time in Vietnam when he was there that they was in such a firefight, and it was so intense that the CO ordered that the dust off choppers quit coming in because it was too hot. The landings of the LZ was too hot. Afraid the choppers couldn't get there. One man laying there knew that he was dying. Knew that he was going to die. Going in and out, in and out. But the soldier that flew that chopper, that Huey that day, kept coming in. Anyway, just ignored the order, just kept coming. And I believe it was 20-something soldiers that that helicopter lifted up out of that firefight wounded. And after he got back to the fire base the last time with the last soldier, they noticed he had 3 bullet wounds in his left leg and 3 in his shoulder. Many people gave a lot in sacrifice for what you and I take for granted so much. You and I, sometimes we just take things for granted. We just assume everything is going to be okay, that everything is going to work out. Today, we want to honor the memories of those who have sacrificed their lives on the altar of freedom, gave their life that I could stand in this pulpit today and preach this message. Right. Sacrificed their life, sacrificed their families so that you and I could be free. Thousands of lives were not given in vain. Because of their sacrifice, we're free today to have the right to come to the house of God and worship the God of our choice. Hallelujah. I don't believe in false gods. I do not believe in false doctrine. I don't believe in all these people running around worshiping the moon and the stars. I don't believe, but besides all of what I believe, what I don't believe is because of sacrifices that men and women made for this country, that people can even believe a lie and still worship what they call a God. It's your and my duty and our responsibility today to remember our soldiers, men and women that have fought to make this country free, that we could worship God. In the Revolutionary War, the best I could come up with on these figures, they don't hold it exact to the figure, but it's pretty close. On the Revolutionary War, 25,324 died. In the Civil War, there was 498,332 that died. World War I, there was 116,710 that died. World War II, 407,316 died. Korean War, 54,546 died. Vietnam War was 58,098 soldiers died. First Gulf War, 293 died. Iraq War, 819 died. We honor them today. Let's give our soldiers a great hand of appreciation today. Hallelujah. Thank God somebody sacrificed that I could be free to worship my God. That I can leave that door unlocked. That's what I want to do. I don't have to lock that door. We don't have to lock that door. We got freedom. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. I wouldn't dare try to take away from any of this, from their sacrifice and their service of the men and the women who sacrificed and served our nation so faithfully. I wouldn't dare try to take it away, but I want to talk a little different now I want to go a little different direction. I want to talk about the one who gave all for us. I want to talk about the one that gave his life. When this one walked out of that battlefield, of that spiritual battlefield, when he came from heaven to earth, wrapped himself, according to the text that I read, robed himself in a robe of flesh, and stepped out onto a spiritual battlefield to fight for my soul, to fight that I could be free from sin. He came and he knew when he stepped out there, us Vietnam veterans, we knew that it was possible and maybe even likely that we would not come back from Vietnam. We knew that, but also there was a possibility, a chance, and we knew that if we watch ourselves and pray to God and ask God for help, we would come back. Brother Norton said he would lay many a night, he was talking to me, on his helmet, nothing on the ground but a steel pot, laying his head in the steel pot, and when he wasn't too deep into the jungle war, there that he could look up and see the stars shining and would say, God, am I ever going to get to go home and see my family? We knew there was a possibility, but Sister Christie, when Christ stepped out onto that battlefield, he knew that he was going to give his life. He knew he was not going back. He knew that he was going to sacrifice everything that I could be free from sin. Praise God. He paid the terrible price that I could be saved. This man gave his life for more than just a nation. He gave his life for all humanity. The Bible said, you quoted that scripture, you had it on the screen earlier, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear me. Look at it. Read it close. What did God love? He loved the world. It wasn't America that he loved. It wasn't Russia that he loved. It wasn't the white man that he loved. It wasn't the black man that he loved. It wasn't the Japanese. It was the world. The world was going to be saved by him. Not just America, honey, it was the world. God so loved the world. This man, when he stepped out on that spiritual battlefield, when he came from heaven to earth, he knew that he was going to make the supreme sacrifice and set me free. Yeah. Amen. Hallelujah. When we read, God was manifest in the flesh, it reminds us of the greatest event in human history. How the Creator, God Himself, stepped out of eternity into time and came into a world as a baby. Jesus laid aside the heavenly and came to this world. He willingly left all to enter this sin, cursed, hate-filled, prejudiced world. Let me tell you, prejudice didn't just start with the white man and the black man. That's not where prejudice began. My Bible said the Jews would have no dealings with the Samaritans. They were prejudiced against them. They even titled them as dogs. Christ stepped out into this hate-filled, cursed world and sacrificed. He came to a world, John 1:11 said, he came into his own, and his own received him not. He came to a world that rejected him. He was hated of men. The Pharisees couldn't love him, didn't love him. The Sadducees didn't love him. The people didn't care. The scribes didn't care. The Jews didn't have anything to do with him. He came to prostitutes. He came to harlots. He came to drunkards. He came to sinners. He came to Samaritans. He came to people just like you and me. She quoted it very well. The unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived. Neither idolaters, neither fornicators, neither effeminate, neither those that abuse themselves with mankind. No liars, no cheaters, nothing, no hatreds, nothing. And such were some of you. He came for you. He came for me. He came to set us free from hatred. He came to set us free from prejudice. He came to set us free from lying and cheating and stealing. He came knowing that he was going to die. Hallelujah. I wish you hadn't shouted so much. You got me all started here. Lord, and sweating. Preachers ain't supposed to have to sweat. They're supposed to be cool, calm, keep their ties straight and their hair straight. Lord forbid if you spit on the back row. Keep you doing that. But what I think of Scripture in 14, 1 and 14 of John, when I think of that Scripture, he came to a land where he was ridiculed, hated, and killed. John said, and the Word was made flesh and dwelled among us, and we beheld his glory.
Hallelujah.
The glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. He lived as a man among men. He died as a man redeeming man from his sin. We must never forget our Savior, the one that died for us. Never forget that our Savior is not and was not an ordinary man. My Bible said, I don't know how your Bible reads. If it don't read like this, you need a new Bible. My Bible reads that God came in human flesh. That's what my Bible said. God was manifest in the flesh. Jesus took upon himself the body of a man. Here was God, the creator of the universe, born as a baby in Bethlehem. The Philippian writer said in 2 and 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of man, of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he was just like a man. He was robed in flesh. He humbled himself and became obedient to death, even the death of the cross. I want to tell somebody here today, every day of our life ought to be Memorial Day. We ought to mark that day every time our unworthy feet hit our floor beside our bed every morning. And God allows you to take a deep breath and breathe the fresh air that God has given us. We ought to mark it as Memorial Day. I remember reading about the Lamb of God that came to take away the badness pointed at him on Jordan and said, behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. Why did he do that? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Here we have God who had made everything that was said. Psalm 50, 12. If I was hungry, I would tell thee. For the world is mine and the fullness thereof. He that made the whole world. Because Jesus left heaven and came to this world, he knew pain. He knew suffering. He knew rejection. He knew thirst. He knew loneliness. He suffered as he did so that we might feel. He might feel our pain and know how to comfort us when our trials come. That's why he died. Seeing then, Hebrews 4, 14, that we have a great high priest that passeth into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our profession. For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted, like as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. When you head down that aisle, if you can't run, you'll at least trot. If you can't trot, you'll walk fast. Somebody said, what was that they called it in the army? Force march. It was a force march. I hated them, man, with a passion. I hated the man that announced it. Get your field pass. Get your rifle. Going on a force march. I just wanted to say, man, if you had asked me yesterday, I could have done it. My back's hurt. I don't think army knew anything about a back. Let me tell you what's going on right here. Let us therefore come boldly. Make an attempt to come to him. Just bring everything down the aisle today. Just bring all your aches and pains and your suffering and your discouragement. Come boldly to the throne of grace. Don't tuck your head. Don't drop your head. Hold your head up high. Brother Norton, you remember the old song? Brother Willingham, Brother Duke, you that have been through boot camp, remember the old song they used to sing to it? Soldier, soldier, don't look down. There ain't no discharge on the ground. Come on, hold your head up, soldier boy. Come on, you get to Vietnam, you're going to have to be looking. I used to think, boy, I wish he wouldn't say that. Come boldly, holding your head up high. To the throne of grace. To the throne of grace. What else did it say that we may obtain? I'm reading Hebrews 4:16. I'm sorry, Brother Joseph. That we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. And then skip down to verse 18. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to secure them that are tempted. Then 1 Peter tells me to cast all my cares upon him. 5 and 7 of 1 Peter. For he cares for me. Amen. Hallelujah. Whoa. What a thought. All right. The Creator cares. See, Jesus didn't come in this world to live. He came in the world to die. For Mark tells us in 10:45. For even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. Jesus Christ, the perfect, sinless one, took my place on a hill called Calvary at an old, rugged cross. He didn't die because he was a bad man. He died because I was a bad man. He came to save that which was lost. He died. He came into this world to save sinners. Paul said, for I was the chiefest among sinners. Paul said, nobody could out-sin me. I was chief among the sinners. This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance that Christ came into the world, 1 Timothy 1:15, to save sinners, of whom I cheat. When Jesus died on the cross, he suffered in ways that Isaiah couldn't even explain. Isaiah said he was so mired and he couldn't even, his ventures couldn't even be recognized. When you saw him, you couldn't recognize him as a man. That's what Isaiah was saying in 52:14 of Isaiah. But all he suffered was for a ransom that I might help. How many in here today has got a relative that maybe died in a war, was killed in a war here? That was because I needed freedom. That was because I needed freedom. All those soldiers that gave their life for their country because I needed. That set me free. We're told that Jesus preached unto the Gentiles, bleed on in the world. And he did it all to save us from our sins. the apostle tells the church at Ephesus. I'm about ready to close. Stay with me just a few minutes. And you have the quick at Ephesians 2:1. Who was dead in trespasses and sin, wherein in time past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the powers of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in time past in the lust of the flesh, fulfilling the desire of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as others. But God, over y'all love this, who is rich in mercy, for his great love, wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath he quickened us together with Christ. By grace are you saved. You talk about grace. The Ephesian writer went on to say in verse 12 of that same chapter that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope without God in the world, but now in Christ Jesus, ye who sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Jesus Christ. You talking about grace? I don't know of anywhere, and this would sound controversial, I guess, and if you take it the wrong way, please forgive me, but I don't know anywhere in the world you could find greater grace than the Old Testament. When you start digging through the Old Testament, I know we're saved by grace. I understand that. I'm not the son of God. But let me tell you, the Old Testament is full of grace. Talking about grace, what grace that God would reach out to people like you and me, wicked people. We're in a wicked world. But God's grace is just steady reaching for people. Steady reaching for people. How do you think people narrowly escape bad things? God's grace. We were going down the 72 highway in my pickup truck years ago, way before I come to come. My wife and I and the girls were in the cab way before the days of car seats and seat belts. Had a young man and a young girl sitting in the back of that pickup truck, sitting with their backs against the cab, riding the car in Mississippi. It was on 72 highway, running at normal, highway speed. And a car turned right in front of me. He's making a left. There's an 18-wheeler tanker pushing him right behind me. But he all of a sudden decides he wants to go that way. No signal, nothing. He just got on his brakes and turned, and I'm right there running highway speed, 18-wheeler running same. He got on the brakes on that old tanker. Man, smoke started boiling. I got on my brakes, and I knew I was fixing to T-bone that dude as sure as anything, and something just happened. Something got a hold of that pickup truck. And besides the brake pedal that I was using, it was an invisible hand just got a hold of that truck and pulled that truck. And that car turned, and I went right on that 18-wheeler steel slab down that highway. You talking about grace to a people that's unworthy, so wicked. Grace that God would fix it so that I could be saved. Grace that we are allowed to hear the truth about salvation. Man, let me tell you something. I wouldn't take nothing. I was so honored to get to stand in a pulpit here several years ago in Thorne, Mississippi. If you don't know where Thorne is, you ain't even live. Thorne, Mississippi. I stood in a pulpit with an open casket in front of that pulpit of the man of God that brought me the truth. Just laying there in his casket, I was honored to be asked to do his service. And I preached the man of God's sermon for his funeral. There, I was honored. I am so blessed to have had a man of God in my life that preached me water baptism in the name of Jesus Christ and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. We're speaking in tongues and living a godly life. I thank God we are so blessed. Grace gives us the opportunity to hear the truth. I told you the other night, I'm going to say it again just for meanness. If you get upset, you're not getting upset with me. You're getting upset with what this is all about. This ain't about me, honey. This is about Him. What grace that the Word of God came to our hearts in the power of the Spirit. Romans 10:17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Thank God for the gospel. I'm going to close with all the thousands that died that I could be free. Thousands have died to guarantee our freedom. Brother Duke, we've got men and women that have sacrificed and gave their blood and guaranteed our freedom. And now our enemy no longer is in a foreign land. Our enemy are our neighbors. Our enemy is an opposing foe that's trying to take everything the Christians stand for away from us. Boy, right now I could preach about an hour and a half on that. That's our enemy. Everything that my forefathers died on the battlefields, gave their life for. Mark McClain, you hear me? Now we're having a fight to defend it. It was for freedom. It was for freedom. They gave their all so that we might enjoy all the blessings of this great land. So today I honor them and their sacrifice. Thank God for every one of them. But I also honor the Lord Jesus. I want to remind us that heaven's best came to the world and died to give us eternal life and freedom from sin. There is therefore, that apostle wrote, there is therefore no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Thank God for truth. Sister Peter, will you play that thing for me? I want to ask you today, are you free? Have you been made free by the blood of Calvary's Lamb? Are you a Christian? If you're not, I want to know why you're not. If you've not given everything to Him, why not? And why not do it today? Why not make that sacrifice today? Maybe you just need to get before Him and talk to Him about some things. Maybe you just want to come and reassure your love for Him and His love for you. I invite you today to Jesus Christ. I invite you to come. I'm His ambassador. I'm asking you to come to Him today. I represent Him. I represent a throne that has no end. I represent a God that has all power. Will you come right now? Everybody that would, stand with me if you would, please. And let's just come boldly. Let's come boldly, Jesus, to the throne of grace. Come down. Come down and pray. God bless these. God bless these young people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Jesus, you're all I need. Jesus, you're all I need. When your gentle, sweet Spirit sweeps over me, it assures me that you're all I need. Jesus, you're all I need. Jesus, you're all that I need. When you're gentle, sweet, peace. At last I lay down, and I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
Even the ones that were not killed in action that have gone on to be with the Lord since, we honor them as well. They fought for our country, so we give them honor today. Our veterans that are here today, of course, we'll say more about the veterans on Veterans Day, but thank you so much for giving everything that you give to the country. We love so good. We love so good. Amen. Sister Hannah's going to bless us, ma'am. If somebody would turn off the lights in the back for me, I'd appreciate it. Just flip all those switches down, sister. God bless you. Go ahead, Hannah. it is, in a way, an odd thing to honor those who died in defense of our country, in defense of us, in wars far away. The imagination plays a trick. We see these soldiers in our mind as old and wise. We see them as something like the founding fathers, gray and gray hair. But most of them were boys when they died, and they gave up two lives, the one they were living and the one they would have lived. When they died, they gave up their chance to be husbands and fathers and grandfathers. They gave up their chance to be revered old men. They gave up everything for our country, for us. We owe them a debt we can never repay. All we can do is remember them, what they did, and why they had to be brave for us. For being here today, always remember, never forget the sacrifice that was made that we could be. Amen. I thank God that we are here. I like what Mr. Reagan said there on that. He said, not only thank God for those men that died, but thank God for those men, how did he say that? In other words, the men that live, that they would sacrifice. Thank God for that. Praise the Lord. We're going to go downstairs in just a minute. Brother Willingham is going to come and close our service. There he is. Now, don't you hide on me. Y'all were supposed to be on my right. No, that's fine. That's fine. So we're going to, then we're going to go downstairs. And it's going to take them a while to get the food ready, I'm sure, but then we'll have some fellowship, some fun. Is the thing outside? Okay, there's going to be a moonwalk or bamfi, whatever you call that thing. The small kid, big kid, y'all can't get in there. Now, if you've got a football or something, you can play that out here on this park, on the bed in the parking lot. Just have a great time and hang around as long as you want to hang around. Just going to have a great time. Would you stand with me in honor to our country and to God? Come on, Brother William Hamby, if you would. He's going to close our service out today. You're dismissed. Be no service tonight. Just going to have some fun downstairs. You're dismissed.